will now call the city council meeting of June 27th to order. First item on the agenda, public input. Anyone that would like to address council about any items on the agenda or that aren't on the agenda can come forward and give their name and address council.
How about if I just stay right here?
No.
My knees might knock out there.
Microphone.
I'm still a paramedic.
Would you can save my knees? I just come in tonight.
Would you give your name, please?
Oh, I'm Pat Mahoney. How you do, Gary?
I'm doing fine.
Okay, good. I just come in to see about the swimming pool here in Caribou for the children of Caribou. That's all. Is there going to be one or not? Or are our kids having to migrate out to Presque Isle, Limestone, or some other place?
Well, I don't think there's a pool in Presque Isle, other than at the university.
I think it should be right here in Caribou. We're always going to Presque Isle or Limestone for something, because there's nothing here in Caribou for the children. There are some things, but this is one of the things I'd like to have an answer on.
I don't think the decision on whether it's going to be a pool or splash pad or... But there is going to be something to
do. They all need to learn how to swim.
Aquatics.
Even us, me as an adult. That's just my question,
yep.
And I'd like to hear a few yays or nays or yep. What is going to be done, anything or nothing.
Anybody from council would like to voice their opinions.
I gave you my answer.
I know.
You know.
Yeah.
So.
But she's not the president.
That's right.
He's in Ottawa.
Timmy, you have any comments or anyone else? I mean, right now, where the pool is, it can't be resurrected there, so.
Well,
until the school thing is settled and decided, I guess.
The city of Caribou can't do nothing until the school decides it's going to... Yeah,
well, I don't know where we'd put it right now if we were going to...
Didn't they close it because it was in such bad shape?
That's why it was closed.
And it's been that way for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and they patched it. But now, we're 2 or 3 years later, the children are still having to go elsewhere. The parents are working to make ends meet, and they still have to take them to Limestone, here, there, wherever. And a lot of them cannot afford to join a pool to take their kids. So
I don't think they have to pay in Limestone, do they?
See, but that's out.
But if they went here and had them.
Yeah. That's out again.
Well, I think there was a long-term plan. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's a long-term plan.
There was money
to fix that solution.
Allocated for it at one time, too.
Yep. You know, we looked into a splash pad. There was a questionnaire that people were asked at a couple of the last referendums. And I think there's a plan to do that. I think the school system and that new location and whatnot is... probably thrown a wrench into if that's really where it's going to be, or is it going to be over by the rec center? So there's probably more questions than answers.
Yeah, I'd like to see some answers and the questions. It's still the children that are having nowhere to go. Me, I can swim in my bathtub, but the children need a place to go. That's my biggest concern.
Well, and another thing, too, the usage was down about 2/3 when it
yeah, because the city couldn't afford lifeguards. So,
you know, you don't
I don't really want to argue.
You don't want your taxes to go up.
My taxes have gone up. I've had an appeal and a whatever, and I was knocked down before I even went in the door. So they knew what they were going to do with me.
Yeah.
That's my feeling. So
it takes money.
Yeah, I know. That's
anyone else have any comments?
That's what I wanted to.
I don't think it's dead yet, Pat. That there won't be a pool or anything. I don't think that decision has been made, and I don't think it will be made until whatever is determined with this school and where it's going to go and what land we're going to have available. And you know, there's no sense building it now or repairing the old one and then tearing it all down here. And we're not going to spend $150,000 on it and then tear it up because we're giving it to the school department to build a new school. So,
But what are they putting into the city for this thing that they're having on Thursday night, and they're remodeling and remodeling and building and cracking down and bringing up again?
Well, I think Thursday night is, Austin, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think $7,000. Now,
that could provide something for a child every 2 weeks or something to swim in, maybe? I don't know. I don't know where I think it should be something done for the children. Because if we don't do things for the children now, there's not going to be anybody coming into the city of Caribou. They'll all migrate, as we all say. They're migrating out. We need people to come in. And people are not going to move to Caribou because, in all actuality, there's not much for the children.
Well, Pat, I mean, we could debate it all night. I mean,
I'm not going to debate it because
I'd be more than happy
things.
To debate what's in Caribou compared to limestone, for instance.
Yeah, I know
how many
you,
people
Gary, I know your opinion.
Here
I'm
going
to
limestone.
Before, and you're the one that talks about migrating out and this and but it's
and
a
my
shame.
Own opinion about migrating in, unless there's jobs here, no.
Yeah, and what do we got for jobs? Caribou used to be a good, booming town, and now it's like a sleepy hollow. There's not too much going on.
Yep. Don't disagree.
I'm finished. I've spoke my piece.
Okay.
I hope you
Thanks
come up
coming.
With something for the children. I'm not leaving yet. I'll sit down for a minute. Thank you.
Anyone else have any public input tonight? All right. Any conflicts of interest from any of the council members on any of the agenda items tonight? No? Considering authorizing minutes of the following meetings, June 13th, 2016, City Council meeting, May 2nd, 2016, Council Workshop, April 13th, 2016, City Council Workshop.
So moved.
Second.
Slight.
Any questions or comments on the minutes? All those in favor? Approved. Consent agenda. Approval of the acting city manager.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Approved. Next item is an Islander Museum plant. And someone from the Islander is going to step forward.
There are two of us.
Probably room for both of you.
Yes. One short, the other's tall. Well,
would you give your names, please?
Oh,
Nelson Ketch.
Gail Heidelstein.
Go ahead.
Thank you.
We're open for questions.
We've done a lot of work since the chamber moved out. Most of the time has been spent on clearing out the Chamber of Commerce stuff. What? Yep. 8 to 10 trips to the transfer station and numerous to other places such as the rec department and the library. That has taken up a lot of our time, and it was really by the skin of our teeth we opened on Memorial Day. Since Memorial Day, we have had between 175 and 200 people come through. And as you saw on the plan, we have a lot going on. We continue to have a lot. And some additions under public relations, Channel X is helping. We've had a story on WAGM and
Grandpa's Attic guy came out a couple weeks ago. Yep. Spent about 3.5 hours out there filming an interview and looking the place over. That should air somewhere in the first week or so of September.
We have also connected with Central Acoustic Chamber of Commerce, and they have bent over backwards to help us. They realize this is a gem, and they don't want to lose it. During midsummer.
Midsummer, we had they're called the Samlot pictures, if any of you have seen them. They're pictures that Olof Nylander took over to Sweden in around the early 1920s, and he had an exhibition over there on the Swedish colony. So there's pictures of from Caribou, Perim, Woodland, New Sweden, some of the surrounding other towns, some of the houses, businesses, farms. And the original pictures, he had them on big poster board, and we had those up at the Swedish Midsummer. The museum up there asked if they could be brought up and put on display up there. And they had, I don't know the exact number, but they had probably a couple hundred come through there looking at them. That was the draw for the building they were in, was the pictures. And a lot of the people that were coming through, they had papers out for them, and we did on Memorial Day also, for people that knew something about those buildings, because a lot of them are still around, people live in them. So we got some of the history coming in on some of those pictures. So we working with some of the other museums on moving displays around and sharing some of the stuff.
And that's all of our PR, part of our PR, is to share what we have with other museums so that we get the word out. And the word is beginning to get out, and we are having a lot of people, especially on Thursdays on Sweden. I don't know about you, but even when I go grocery shopping, people are saying, we're so happy to know that that building is open and that it's being rejuvenated. I have talked to homeschoolers. They're rather interested in coming because it fits in. I know with a former retired teacher on the council, he never talked to superintendents until the middle of July. So that will be my job this summer, is talking to superintendents, principals, and science teachers. In fact, I talked with someone yesterday because of an unusual incident about making sure that the main learning results and the Common Core are all tied in, because I happen to do projects for 10 years on that particular aspect that the 9 language covers. I'm going to suggest that they do that as a project, and I'm even willing to go in and help. So the education part is also. So we are moving along.
We have a relative of Olaf Islanders. He's a great-great-grandchild. He's a paleontologist, geologist, and collects shells, does everything that Olaf Islander did. And he's on the board of directors down in one of the Boston Museum of Science places. And he's very interested in helping out with us up here, and he'd like to become a board member, because we would like him also, because he'd be our technical advisor and how to properly archive our items, get things right there. And he was going to fly up for our opening, but due to the weather, couldn't. He's planning on coming up soon here this summer. He does own property in Maine, down in Littleton. But he's only been up here once as an adult, and that was a few years ago, to meet his father before he passed away, and they met with Kimber at the museum. That's where they met. So he has a big interest in helping us get things right and make sure everything's archived properly and all that. The wing, I don't know if all of you have been through the museum or not. The Chamber of Commerce was in the middle. The one side had some of the fossils and just a little bit of the shell stuff. The other side was more of a meeting room, and it had the taxidermy in there from Mr. Solomon. And we've rearranged that room and brought the shells, quite a few of the shells and the butterflies back out, because there's always a bug collection. And our butterfly collection, they're not local, they're from around the world. I was donated by a retired military person that brought those in a number of years ago. I remember seeing them when I was in the 70s, when I was a teenager. They used to be there. We have around 40,000 shells, of which not very many are upstairs right now. Olaf collected them or traded with people. A lot of them are like pinhead size, and they came right out of the Rustic River, the Caribou Stream, a lot of the little tributaries and things around here. And they've had people interested in those in the recent past on coming up and finding the same species in all those same places, and then doing DNA sampling between our 100-year-old collection and what's today to see what's, what the changes might be.
And what's been interesting is watching grandparents bring their grandchildren, or parents bring their children, saying, I used to live here during the summers. And so they're excited that their children or grandchildren have the same opportunities.
I had three people from Caribou, probably my age, And they came up to me, and all three of them said the same thing, that my babysitter used to bring us by here every day on our walk home from work or from school. Another person said, I used to just come in all the time, and it prompted me to take geology classes later in life. And he has quite a collection of rocks himself now because of that. The person that came by almost every day with his babysitter, he was standing there beside a little display case with a trilobite about that big in it. And he goes, that was my favorite fossil. He said, I came here every time. That was my favorite fossil to look at. And he was so excited to still see it sitting there. We have some Native American artifacts from around Maine, the Moosehead Lake, some of the stuff in different places. And we've had a donation of, about three cases of books on just Native American, every subject there is about them downstairs. And I've put a few of them out on display. And we have one display case that's all Indian artifacts, a lot of them that Olaf Nylander recovered and found. But we have other books downstairs, just old writings, some from Olaf Nylander, some from other people. We have a book coming from the Oklahoma University in Norman, Oklahoma. And so far it's one Olaf Nylander wrote. And remember, can you speak to that?
Okay.
Well, it's the only one in existence we know of so far, and they're supposed to send it to us so we can at least make a copy of it.
There's three books that Olaf Nylander, that University of Oklahoma at Norman has. University of Maine has a copy of one of them, and it happens to be the one at Oklahoma that is in the worst shape, and they've decided they really don't want to send that one. I said, that's good, because we can get a better one from UMaine. And having graduated from UMaine twice, they're inclined to loan them to me. And one is on orchids, but one is on the one that we're getting from UMaine is on Poseidon rocks. Now, I don't know if you've seen Poseidon rocks, but they're rocks that form within rocks, and they're separate, and they're perfectly round, and they just nestle inside each other.
You can crack open, you can find them up on Madawaska Lake. You can crack open a rock, and another one comes out. What's different about them, they're conglomerate, which means normally on a seashore with mud and stuff, there's a little pebble seed, something. With the wave action, gathers mud, makes a rock, it stops moving, everything else settles on top of it, and you'll find these things laying around all over the place up in Madawaska Lake and woodland. And they'll have indentations where a rock was, or at the museum we get all kinds of them. They're from baseball size down. And what's different about these ones, there is no seed, no start or anything in them. At the time that he was finding those, there's nowhere else on the planet that they were formed like that. We have quite a collection of them. He'd sent them all over the world, and scientists would crack them open. None of them could figure out how they got started at the time. So he named them a Poseidon rock after Poseidon. The reason I brought up the books was a lot of people have told us that we should get a hold of the Stephen King Foundation, because they worked on providing money to preserve anything to do with books. And so we don't have a large amount of books there, but we get enough to probably line up from one end of your table to the other if you got everything together. From all different ages, over 100 years old, up through and on the subjects that the museum covers.
Any questions?
Anybody from council have any questions?
Yeah, I got.
Good.
Don't ask.
What is the intent behind your 501c3 Friends of the Nylander?
It is under construction right now. All the information is in the hands of a local lawyer, and I have to buy him a case of Bud Light, and he will do that part for free. So hopefully by the end of the summer that will be in place, and we will start advertising the fact that we have a 501c3 for the Friends of the Nylander, and that also means we are able to go after grants other than the Tabitha and the Stephen and Tabitha King.
And one other thing has to do with the front doors.
Oh dear goodness, they're awful. someone comes in and shakes them, it automatically sets it off. I set it off a week and a half ago, because all I did was try to open it, and...
You didn't arrest her, did you?
You just visited her.
Yeah.
I've been visiting, too.
Yeah. There is a gap on those new doors, literally that wide, from the handle down, so it's letting in a lot of hot air, or it's letting in a lot of cold air. And with our first Stephen and Tabitha King grant, we hope to replace those doors as well as replace the ramp, which is falling apart along the back.
So is there any adjustments that can be made to those fairly new doors to...
Somebody may be able to do some weather stripping type stuff somewhere to help them, but like I say, the wind kind of blows through them.
Because those were new, put in new.
Yes.
They're still shiny and new looking, too.
Yeah, they are. Unfortunately, they're not very efficient.
They're supposed to be energy efficient.
Yeah.
And that may be something was missing from them of that, to tighten them up just right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they could. They stand a little bit. One of our other things that the relative I mentioned, that's into this. His big thing is he wants to work through the museum to help with the STEM program and the science fair thing with the schools, because he was the Massachusetts state winner two or three times growing up. He took national to the United States twice, I believe, and once international. And he's in charge of the science fair whole thing for Massachusetts. And he wants to be involved with that up here through the museum, where we could help out with science fair items. And he also works with getting money through the STEM program, parceled out to schools for different things there. And they have to have an organization such as a museum to funnel that stuff through.
Is he going to be able to attend your board meetings?
Not all the time, no. He is planning on
when
he's out here.
Would it be better to enlist him as an advisor versus being a board member?
That's a good idea.
He could. The only reason he was checking on board members when you do go out for grants, which was one of his jobs at the multi-million dollar level for some of the other museums he works on, is as a board member you have no pull because you're part of the system. It was the only reason he was looking at it from that angle. Although he's basically a technical advisor is what you'd say.
And there's no reason why, if he does become a board member, why we can't use Skype or FaceTime.
Yeah, there is.
What?
State laws can't do that.
Why?
Because they don't allow it because of public proceedings.
Yeah, he's not there. So.
The
thing is, this gentleman, because he is a descendant of Nylander, he is automatically considered an honorary board member according to our charter. All descendants of Olaf Nylander, according to the charter,
you can make him a board member, even
yes.
According to the
yes, according to the board, but as it is right now,
so
whether or not he attends, he could be, you know, our advisor, but he's an honorary board member automatically just by virtue of the fact that he's a descendant of Olaf
Nylander.
Honorary
board members don't vote, though. Right?
No, but he's a technical advisor. He can help.
Yes.
But that was why I asked the question.
Okay. And I didn't know about Skype or FaceTime. Yeah. Thank you.
That's all right.
Any other questions?
No, I'm done.
Well, I'm glad to see there's a plan. It's a great start.
Mm-hmm.
I think the biggest thing... I mean, I read through all the goals and different things you're going to do. I did want to ask, who are the heuristic aspirations? I don't know who those are.
The heuristic aspirations you will see on WAGM between 6 and 6:30 in the morning, because Sean always interviews them. It's the, what's the family?
Govan
Scholars. And
okay.
So they are pushing not only education but higher education, and I've been in contact a lot with Bill Flagg, and he has suggested interns. They are the ones who help clean the building during their volunteer day, which was on a Saturday. So there are a lot of opportunities there.
Yep. Well, I think the biggest thing right off the bat is that you get volunteers. And I mean volunteers on an ongoing basis, not just to come in and do one project, because if you can get some volunteers, maybe you can have the place open on Saturday and Sundays.
That's one of the big goals.
That is.
And that's where the Friends of the Nylander people that are signing up.
Yeah.
I don't know how many we have so far, but...
We have about a half dozen.
About a half dozen.
And I mean, that's the only way you're going to create the interest, by being open.
And a lot of those people in the past that I've seen signing up have been part of the museum in the past, and they're interested in coming in and keeping it open during those days, because we're not open very many hours right at the moment.
No.
But we were open Saturday during midsummer all day, and Sundays were there 1 to 3 right now, but that's the plan is to expand that. And we also will be available to, usually if we can set up a time to show to a group, like at that's last Thursday on Sweden Street. There's a women's auxiliary or something. I think it's a women's auxiliary from, might have been the VFW or Legion. I'm not sure which one I was talking to. But she has about 30 women in the group, and they like going places like this. And she's asking how they'd be able to set that up.
Yeah.
So we gave them a number, and they'll call them, and we'll set up a time, and we can open it up at different times. And same with once the school starts, we'll be able to get somebody there in certain days. Because we all work or have different times that we can, usually somebody can be available.
And another reason we need more volunteers is, right now, the five of us are carrying this on our shoulders. And if someone is ill on a Sunday, and they're supposed to be on deck, and they can't make it, and the rest of us are busy, that means that the museum is not going to be open. So we do need more than just the five of us, and we realize that.
Yeah, yeah. All right, well, we'll appoint a council person to sit with you on the board.
Good.
And if there's anyone interested, they can let me know here. If not, I'll just end up appointing someone, I guess.
Okay.
Any other questions? Well, thank you very much for coming, and good luck.
Okay, thank you.
Dangerous buildings. Manager, please.
Back in August of 2014, the council declared the buildings on the land owned by NASA Flanda LLC to be dangerous and ordered the removal of them. To date, none of the buildings have been removed by the owner. One building was removed by the city, with the cost applied to the 2015 property taxes. The buildings that still stand today have not been repaired since 2014, and they are currently in worse condition now than they were then. I've spoken with the owner of the property several times since 2014. He always said that he'll be taking the buildings down. Just as he did with the council in 2014, he continues to give vague timelines, and when timelines are specific, he makes no visible attempt to meet them or to communicate anything with the city. The city's been patient, has tried to work with the owner to see the buildings removed, but I believe the city should no longer take the wait-and-see approach in these buildings. I fear that the longer we take this approach, the more likely it is the buildings could collapse, with potentially devastating results, especially the old freezer building. In consulting with legal counsel, they believe the city still has the legal authority to demolish the buildings and assess the cost back to the property owner based upon the dangerous buildings actions that were taken. So I'm asking tonight if the council would like to pursue the city having the buildings demolished and removed at this point in time, or if that is not something the council is interested in pursuing in right now.
Any comments or questions from council?
Are the 215 taxes paid?
No.
How much are they?
Roughly $40,000.
And what was it in 2014?
$13,000.
And those were paid?
2014 taxes, he has to pay those by the end of November this year, or else we'll foreclose on it. He's paid the 2013 taxes.
Okay. I think we should do something, but I don't think the city should invest all kinds of money if we don't own the place, because we're not going to get grants if we don't own it, correct?
Correct.
But I think we should keep putting the pressure on Mr. Nassif, and if we add $20,000, $25,000 worth of in-kind labor, I don't know, can I ask Mr. Ouellette, could you take down some of those buildings and leave it there?
We're not equipped to take down the big buildings. We don't have anything that can reach that far. The one we took down at the very corner was about the length, the scope of our reach. But as far as that freezer building, we have no way to do that.
I think that we should at minimum take down the freezer building and, I mean, get a quote, get a bid, or, and have it just demolished so that it won't fall into the road if it's down. And part two of the bid, how much to haul it out. And
I think you'd have to haul it out. I don't think you could just put it on the ground, because the problem is dangerous buildings, and if you got it all tore down sitting there in a pile, it's a pretty dangerous situation too.
Well, so. Not as dangerous as it is now. Who's gonna sue you? The only one that can do anything about that is the city.
Yeah, all I'm saying is if you tear that building down and have it in piles there, you know, if kids go in there and start going into it, you could have a worse situation than you got now.
I think we would certainly want to have it removed.
Anyway, yeah, I think it would have to be removed. I don't think we can just...
I'd like to see a price for tearing it down and another price for hauling it away.
Can you find him? Can you set a fine or something for the days that he's not... I mean, we've already ordered that be taken down. Can you find him, or can you take him to court and get a court order that...
The relief is still the same. The city takes down the building and charges to the property taxes. If we want to kind of take a step backwards and go after the property maintenance code, we could try to do that and issue fines, but I don't know how well that would work out since we've already gone the steps of dangerous buildings.
Yeah.
I don't think that would be advisable from a legal standpoint.
So I think it's too bad to keep putting this off and letting him play these games and...
But if we, do you think we could get that thing down for $25,000?
Oh.
I mean, I don't know.
$250,000.
Don't we
get a price? No, I'm talking just one building, the freezer building.
The freezer building. It's $250,000.
It's a big building.
It's a big building. It's, no.
The rough estimate when we first started this process was somewhere in the vicinity of $600,000 for all.
Well, we can't afford $250,000. But we could tear down some of it. Just keep adding the bill. So when the bill gets to be $100,000, he's either going to pay or he's going to give up the property.
When did the assessments go on the bill of the work that we've done already?
2015 is when they went on.
So they're on there now?
Right.
Okay. And so with his 2014 and 15 taxes, what is his total obligation to us now?
Roughly 53,000, something right in there.
Has his obligations been that much in the past when he's waited till the last minute?
He's always waited till the last minute, but it's never been that high.
So
2015 taxes would be the highest.
He would be struggling probably at a minimum next November, if not this November.
Well, he bought out the mortgage.
Next November.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He bought out the mortgage, mm-hmm. So well, that was more money invested in it. I mean, I don't know what he paid for it, but he bought it out.
Right.
Well, let's invest another 25, 30, whatever, and keep the pressure on him. And at some point, we're either going to collect the money, or he's going to say uncle, and then we can go apply for grants to clean it up properly.
And he filed for bankruptcy and all that?
He can.
Mm-hmm. Put it in somebody else's name, maybe, and he's clear.
But the hazard transfers with the property, so it doesn't make any difference whether he gets out from underneath it or not. The issue is still valid, and it transfers with the property because he's in violation of the state law, criminal code.
You know, part of the game we're playing too here is if, you know, that building ever does fall down and falls the wrong way in the road, that's going to be a costly endeavor to get that picked up.
Then the state can go after him.
You can bet he's got no insurance anywhere, any liability. There won't be any payment on his end.
Would be a good answer.
That's true. It will fall on state property.
Mm-hmm. As long as nobody gets hurt.
Well, that's the main
thing right there.
We've already declared it a dangerous building, so if we've declared it, the city's declared it, I would think that we have some liability whether it fell in the road or not.
had another question. If somebody tore it down, could you haul?
I think we could. We could help with the hauling of it, yeah.
And I mean, even if it took a couple of years.
Right, and as long as it wasn't a project that was a priority, if it was a fill-in job where you could put, you know, rainy day projects where you could put six trucks in a loader to go haul for 2 days.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if it was used as a fill-in job, the public works would help if it was down. Until it's down, though, there's nothing that we can do from our department.
The best thing to do if you take it down is to clean it all up at that time. Because you just take one hazard and create another.
It's not going to fall in the road if you take it down. And if you're working at it, you're doing a lot more than's been done. I'd like to see us get a quote on it, what it costs to tear it down.
Nothing wrong with getting a quote.
I mean, ask the Navy if they want to do target practice on it or something.
That's the police department. They want target practice for those big ones.
Because you're right. If we've declared it dangerous and we're sitting here 2 years later, haven't done, well, we can't say we've done nothing. The liability question, that's, you knew it, why didn't you do something about it? Define what we should have done.
I want to be sure, too, that he is liable for the costs before we do it.
He is liable for the costs. It's all
the name change and everything doesn't have any effect or anything.
It's the still owner. The mortgage was bought out by Kiwi Realty Trust, but the land is still owned by NASF Land LLC. They both have the same address, which is his home in Massachusetts.
Gary, could the council members talk to a lawyer and see what all the...
We've already done all of that.
Have you done your homework? Okay.
I just want to be sure because we have had another instance with our boilers, for instance, where everything was supposed to be in place and was an airtight deal, and we all know where that ended up, so. And I know that's before your time.
Has the asbestos been taken out of them buildings yet?
Yeah, asbestos.
From what we've been told by the DEP, we would confirm that again before tearing it down, obviously, but.
Yeah.
And who, somebody was supposed to be taking down a couple of those smaller buildings for him, too, and there's no activity there either?
I haven't seen any activity on that either. Yeah, that was Kent Forbes.
Right.
Why don't we get the crew that was going to take the steam plant down at the lowering? See what they can do for us.
Yeah, oh, I thought you were up here that time, wasn't it?
And when they do that wrong, are they going to blame the potato storage facility being new cottoned?
Yeah. There's going to be some salvage money in that. Anyway, what does council want to
see
do?
See what our liability is now that we've identified the problem also, please. I don't think that we're liable because he still owns the property and he's been issued the summons. He's liable to clean it up.
I make a motion that we get a quote on taking down the freezer building.
Second.
And then also a quote on hauling it away, and then we'll find out we can't afford that, and then we'll have Public Works work on it when they can.
All right, we have a motion on the floor. All those in favor?
Can I comment on that? Oh, sorry. We should. I think before, and I'm okay with that, what I'm concerned about is, I think we've gotten quotes before on that. We're asking for another quote here too. Soon, the local contractors that are quoting on this are gonna go, this isn't real. So, I wanna make sure that if we're doing it, or it's my recommendation that we do it right. If this is what we wanna do, and it's a viable solution to the problem, put it out for an RFP, and get a proposal. Because, I don't know, you go back and forth on proposals like that, and it's, you know, pretty soon you're just gonna start getting junk.
Yeah, but no, this is different. We wanna do something, and we wanna do it. I mean, we can't spend $250,000, or I'm not in favor of that. But if we can get it torn down.
I guess I'm in favor of that if we're gonna push through and make that happen.
Okay, let's decide how much money we wanna spend then. Well, that's not very good as far as asking for quotes.
I think kind of having given this some thought over the weekend too, what I think would be the best option is to go up for bids and put a time frame on it for the demolition. Right now you're not going to get any good bids from a contractor, but it would make a pretty decent winter type project. So if you give them till a completion date of April 1st or May 1st of next year, I think that would give them time to do it over the winter months. I think we would see better bids as a result of that. If we try to go out to bid right now and have it done by September 1st, your bids are going to be quite high.
Work schedule's already chosen for the summer.
Right. Yeah. It's a good winter project. I guess my concern is if you go off a bid and it comes back at, you know, $400,000, I'm not hearing a whole lot of support for that. I would support it, but I'm not hearing a lot of support. And to me, going after RFP after RFP after RFP is just, you know, you're wasting time and taking people off. So that's just my opinion.
Each year the cost of living goes up, so they're going to want their wages going up too, whoever disposes of it.
Anyway, do you want to amend your motion to put time frame on it till next May the 1st?
I'd rather do it so that it's done when the ground is frozen. I mean, not that we can hurt that land much, but...
I said May 1st.
Yeah.
This is Caribou.
It used to be that way. No anymore.
Yes,
I'll amend the motion to...
Before mud season. Before mud season. Make it before mud season.
Before mud season. Before the roads are posted. How's that? When do you post?
I can post in February. It just depends if the roads are thawing, but they can haul at night. If the roads are froze, they can haul on posted roads. And from here to the landfill, or from there to the landfill, it's not on posted roads anyway.
Right.
But we don't have to worry about that.
Okay, May 1st.
Loading.
May 1st, 2017?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
All right, then we have a second. All those in favor? Approved. Selling of tax-acquired property, Manager Bates.
We recently went out for bids on tax-acquired property. We received bids on three pieces of land. Map 30, lot 162B, minimum bid was $50. We received a bid of $100, that's a typo there. The bid was for $100 from Scott Englund. Map 31, lot 21, minimum bid of $2,500. We received a bid of $5,150 from Ken and Kim DeFuller. Map 34, lot 176, minimum bid $50. We received a bid of $50 from Scott Englund. We would need the council to approve to sell these properties. Late Friday afternoon, we received an offer of $500 from Jeremiah Flannery for the property at 60 Woodland Road, map 37, lot 27. It had been put out for bid for $500 with the condition the buildings on the property be demolished within 6 months. We didn't receive any bids on that property. The buyers, given the $500, he'll sign a consent agreement stating the buildings be removed by January 1st, 2017. As long as the council approves that here tonight. We would, if the council chooses to approve that, we also want to abate the remaining taxes on the property in the amount of $2,319.23.
Move the slate.
Second.
Including the one mentioned. Okay. All those in favor? Approved. Ordinance to city or to sell city-owned property.
As we continue the process to try and sell as much surplus and unnecessary city-owned land as we can, we've come across a handful of properties that it's currently under city ownership that we would need an ordinance approved before we could sell them. The list is as follows: Map 2, Lot 36; Map 30, Lot 23; Map 31, Lot 186; Map 33, Lot 7; Map 33, Lot 11A. Map 38, 86A, Map 31, 153, and Lot 154, and Map 34, Lot 185. The ordinance could be introduced tonight in a public hearing scheduled for July 11th. If the council approves the ordinance on July 11th, we would put these bids out, put these properties out for bid with the other tax-acquired property that is still owned by the city on approximately July 20th. The bids would be open in time for the council to act on them at their August 8th meeting.
I take it these are all just lots, there's no buildings on any of these?
All just lots, correct, yep.
Okay.
Introduce ordinance number 9, 2016, City of Caribou, County of Aroostook, State of Maine, an ordinance regarding the sale of municipal property. And schedule a public hearing for the next council meeting.
All right, so we'll have a public hearing at the next meeting. It'll be July the 11th or something? Yeah, okay. All right. Setting the 2016 mill rate and tax commitment.
So there's a few things that need to be understood and taken into consideration as part of our discussion here tonight on the mill rates. First, in 2015, the city collected $3,925,438 in property taxes, and we had an overlay of $89,129 for a total of $4,014,566. The proposal tonight is for the city to collect $3,798,651 in property taxes with an overlay of $92,853 for a total of $3,891,504, which is less than 2015 by $123,062. This is achieved because we'll be reimbursed by the state next year, $137,209 in homestead exemption and the Betty reimbursements. The line for the county taxes is up by $33,965 this year compared to last year. Taxes for the RSU are up $76,476 for the calendar year compared to last calendar year. The mill rate for 2016 is recommended to be set at 22.9, which is up from 22.46, where it is at in 2015. Because of the homestead exemption changes, most homeowners will see a tax decrease. We listed out some examples there for a home at $96,000. Their property taxes would go down roughly $80. $155,000 house taxes would go down roughly $50. And $234,000 house, their taxes would go down about $16. So those are our examples. Take only the homestead exemption into consideration. The state made changes to the veterans exemption, which could impact those that qualify for that exemption and lower their tax bill. If somebody doesn't qualify for the homestead exemption, obviously they wouldn't receive it. So tonight the council needs to set the mill rate and approve the other motions, as has been done historically and laid out below. The following seven items need to be acted on, could be acted on in one motion. The revenue budget adjustments for the property taxes overlay Betty and homestead reimbursement, as reflected on the mill rate calc sheet and on the next page. Set a mill rate for the commitment of 2016 property taxes, which is recommended at 22.9. Setting the commitment date for 2016 property taxes to be committed to the tax collector as of July 1st, 2016. Establishing a date for the 2016 taxes that will be due and payable, which is recommended for July 1st, 2016. Consider establishing a date for interest to begin accruing on any delinquent 2016 taxes. Historically, we've done it on October 1st, and that's recommended again this year. Establishing a rate of interest to be charged on delinquent taxes pursuant to state law, recommended at the state rate of 7%. And establishing a rate of interest for the overpayment and or abatement of property taxes for 2016, recommended at 3%, as has been done historically. We do list out the changes to the revenue lines, the property taxes overlay, homestead exemption, and Betty reimbursement. Occasionally, I have in the past received the question about why we charge tax or interest on 2016 taxes while it's still 2016. Most banks that hold property taxes in escrow will not pay the property taxes until just before interest starts accruing. As a large majority of our property taxes are paid through escrow, this would put a very large strain on the cash flow if we move the interest start date to a later point in time. I do want to thank the assessing team, Penny Thompson and Tony Mischa, for their hard work and the numbers of hours they put into having this ready for the inclusion in the council packet. And the mill rate calculation sheet is on the following pages for the council as well.
Any questions or comments? Are we all right?
Move the slate.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Passed 4-1. Other business. Anyone have any other business? I have one question. A man lift that's sitting outside here, down below. Who's paying for that man lift? I hope it's not us.
the contractor who's
been there forever. I mean, I've seen somebody on it maybe twice in the last 2 months.
I think you pay when you turn the key on.
I don't think so.
No?
It's by the week.
I can't imagine, no. Anyway, as long as we're not paid for it, I don't care, but just. Anybody else have any other business?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? We're adjourned.